We are recording. And we're only recording. We're not going live. And ladies and gentlemen, come on, start up there, music. Won't start. There we go. This is Ham Radio Now, the most important amateur radio program on the internet. And this is a special edition, Digital Voice 2023, VHF and UHF edition. And I'm Gary Pierce, KA4AAQ. I'm the King of Ham and the East Coast host of the Ham Radio Now program. If you're just getting to this special edition because you're led to it by somebody who said, hey, come check out the VHF or the digital voice stuff. This guy knows his stuff about digital voice. Then I welcome you to check out the rest of our program. I'll tell you a little bit about it in a second. I gave this talk in March 2023 to a forum at the Charlotte Hamfest. And I had about 10 people in the audience. And there were a few other people, at least, that said, oh, I missed your talk. Is it going to be, or what, did you record it? Did you record it at the Hamfest? Which I didn't. I've recorded lots of other people doing Hamfest presentations, but I didn't record myself doing it. So I said, I will record it, and I'll put it online and put it here for you. For the folks in the Charlotte area, Charlotte, North Carolina, and I have updated it somewhat for a national audience as well. Probably not worldwide if you're doing digital voice someplace else, Europe, Africa, South America, whatever. The basics will hold, but there's nothing special directed just for you guys. Okay, so once again, this is the Digital Voice for Amateur Radio, VHF and UHF edition, as presented to the Charlotte Hamfest. And if you look at this slide, you see the digital voice modes that exist in ham radio: P25, D-Star, Yaesu System Fusion, DMR, NXDN, and M17. And this program is dedicated to Roland W9HPX, a ham in the Charlotte area. Roland made this presentation at the Charlotte Hamfest for many, many years, and he passed away in December 2022, right around Christmas time. And so he basically handed it off to me to continue the legacy of doing this program at the Charlotte Hamfest and now for you around the world. So the first question that I get often when I talk to people about digital voice is why? Why would anybody want to do digital voice? FM is just fine. And well, part of the reason is because we can. You know, it's like that mountain that's sitting there. Why do people climb mountains? Because they can, because it's there. But there's some other good reasons we'll get to in a little bit. I am Gary Pierce, K4AAQ, formerly KN4AAQ. I was first licensed back in 1965. My focus for most of my ham career has been on VHF and UHF and repeaters, and I've been doing the digital voice thing since around 2006. That was my first introduction to it. I do the Ham Radio Now program on YouTube, on Facebook Live, and as a podcast. We've been doing that since 2012. My co-hosts are David Goldenberg, W0DHG, and Jim Aspinwall, NO1PC, and we have guests and other folks come on and talk about stuff. I will warn you, if you haven't experienced the program together, program before, we ramble. We chase rabbits down holes, and we talk a lot. We're somewhat knowledgeable about what we talk about, but not always. And don't expect to hear a TED Talk or a highly formatted lecture in our programs. People complain about that sometimes, but other people love it. They like the chemistry. I also produced this DVD that you see here called Digital Voice for Amateur Radio. I produced that way back in 2008. That's 15 years ago. It is now available on YouTube as a Ham Radio Now episode. Episode looks like 381. For Digital Voice 2008. If you go to YouTube and just search Digital Voice 2008, this will come up. The program is dated, of course, and the information that it presented, it was current as of 2008. But I think in terms of history, you might enjoy watching that program at some point. As far as I can tell, it's the only doc, and that is a documentary style. There's no rambling on that. It's it's highly produced and scripted and all that. A very Ken Burns style documentary on digital voice from 2008. So, and as you can see from the era of that DVD, digital voice is not all that new. P25 has been around. That slide that I got for P25 that says 30 years of P25, that slide is probably about 5 years old. I think P25 has now been around for about 35 years, long enough that several generations of P25 radios have been obsoleted by the government agencies that use them. They don't keep them more than 10 years. So even though at the 10-year point, the radio is still perfectly functional, they don't want to hang on to it any longer. So they sell it used pretty cheap, and hams have been picking them up and doing P25 and ham radio for quite a while. DMR, D-Star, NXDN, they got started in the early 2000s. D-Star was actually invented right around the year 2000. Fusion is kind of the new kid. It got started in 2013. And M17 is the baby. It is still being experimented on. I'll talk a little bit about that in a little bit, but not very much. Even though it's been around for a while now, D-Star, like almost 25 years old, it's still niche. And I pronounce that word niche, not niche, but do it whatever you want. P25, NXDN, which is for Kenwood, is called NextEdge, and in ICOM, it's called IDAS. They are all used in amateur radio, and they have some ardent supporters, and there's some networking for them, but their use is way below all of the others. So they are a niche of a niche. There's no P25 or NXDN radios that are made specifically for the ham radio market. M17 is a special case. Again, I'll talk about that a little bit more later on. But I'm going to stick with D-Star, Fusion, and DMR for the rest of this talk. And that's why the P25, NXDN, and M17 slides are kind of fading out. Okay, now I'm going to do a little demo. Let me put myself back on the screen. To let you hear what these modes sound like, I've got a serious collection of handy talkies sitting in front of me. I'm going to push the microphone away and talk to you through a couple of radios. Now, this is going to give you an idea of what these things sound like, but only an idea. I mean, you're going to be hearing them as represented by a tiny handy talkie speaker played into a microphone and then whatever you're listening on. So this is not totally representative of the sound and the fidelity and all, but it'll give you an idea. So, first, this is Analog FM, talking on 5.2, K4AAQ testing, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, this is plain old Analog FM, and going through two ICOM IC92 handheld radios.
This is D-Star.
There's a little latency, which makes it harder for me to talk. Because it's coming back in my earphones
a little bit late.
But this is what D-Star sounds like. Again, represented by a tiny handy talkie speaker and through my microphone.
This is really hard to do.
Let's go to DMR. Okay, here we are. DMR.
It's only louder because that radio turned up a little bit more.
Still the latency? Going to a couple of TYT radios.
So maybe it sounds a little different than D-Star. I'm not sure.
Let me go back to D-Star.
I turned the volume up a little bit.
I think more of the difference of what you hear is just microphone and speaker. And not mode, but people do say there's a little difference in the sound of the modes.
Some folks think DMR sounds better than D-Star.
I don't know.
I think it's more speakers, microphones, and equipment based rather than the mode itself.
You may notice I am not doing a Fusion demo because I don't have a Fusion radio, so. There'll be some Fusion that I'll talk about in this, but it's mostly going to be from what I've learned about Fusion by looking online. Okay, back to why. You know, because we can, but there's some other good reasons too. There's no noise in in digital radios. You've heard the idea that there's that digital cliff, the signal's there or it's not. So there's no mobile fluttering, there's no picket fencing, there's no random noise from RF pollution, you know, when you pull up to a stoplight and suddenly the squelch on your radio opens up with raucous noise on your FM radio. That doesn't happen, can't happen on the digital voice nodes. No noisy weak signals. Note the little asterisk I've got there. We'll be back to the asterisk in just a minute. Also, in addition to the no noise things, these modes are born to network. They do work standalone, and I've heard people say, you can't use DMR or D-Star on just a repeater. They've got to be on the internet, on a network. And if there's no internet, they stop working. That is not true. They work fine standalone. They work fine simplex. But they thrive on networking. And the networking, you know, being on the internet, can be around the state, around the country, around the world, any place. And they can also use little devices called hotspots, which is a very important addition or aspect of the digital voice modes, but I'm going to talk about them quite a bit later in this talk, so stay tuned. That asterisk, there's no noisy weak signals. Okay, so what's that all about? The signals are there until they're gone. Well, that's what you've heard. And yeah, you know, that's pretty much true. But at the threshold, right at the bottom of the signal level, just before they disappear entirely, there can be some garble. They can kind of come and go. They can dither a little bit. D-Star has an issue with something they call R2-D2, which plagued the early D-Star radios. You know, maybe not so much with the newer radios. I've got a collection of older radios, and I've just bought a new, new to me anyway, ICOM 5100. I don't get the garble so much, the D-Star R2-D2 type garble. You know what R2-D2 is? It's a little droid on Star Wars that talks and whistles and beeps. And yeah, D-Star kind of sounded like that, and it would go on for a long time. But again, not so much on the newer radios. Anything else about digital voice that's wonderful? Well, yeah, the range, it's about the same as FM. Some people claim it's better. Some people adamantly say that it's worse. My experience is it's pretty much about the same. Maybe the thing about that is that is at the point where a digital voice signal completely disappears, if you could hear the same signal in analog, if you got a radio that you could switch over to analog, there might be a little bit of signal left that you could hear from an analog transmitter. And if it's well modulated, you would be able to understand the speech when it's a little bit weaker than the digital voices are pulling out, a little bit, if it's well modulated, but it's still going to be very, very noisy. Also, some data can ride along with digital voice. I'm not going to talk about that much, and I haven't played with it very much, but it does happen. A little bit of data goes right along with the voice. GPS information travels along with a D-Star signal and with a fusion signal, and you can send some short text messages. And again, I've never actually done that. And then another advantage of one of the modes, DMR, it's actually got two voice channels in one RF channel, and I'll detail that coming up. Something else that is kind of important is that they are narrow band. DMR and Fusion are 12.5 kilohertz wide. D-Star is only 6.25 kilohertz wide. And so by comparison, analog FM goes out to 16 kilohertz wide on voice peaks. It doesn't sit there fully 16 kilohertz wide all the time. And by the way, the DMR, Fusion, and D-Star signals, they fill their spectrum 100% all the time. The D-Star only hits the limits of his spectrum on voice peaks. But with FM, it will go out to 16 kilohertz wide. So you need a channel that's going to be at least that wide. And the narrow FM that hasn't really gotten into ham radio very much, just talk about it. It is most of the FM on public safety and commercial stuff is now narrow FM. And that goes out to 11 kilohertz wide. This is mostly important to frequency coordinators, which means they can squeeze in repeaters in between some existing channels. On UHF, they can just plunk them in. UHF ham radio channels have been 25 kilohertz apart, with enough space in between them that you could put these little narrow digital modes in between almost wherever you want. On 2 meters, not so easy. 2 meters, in many areas, the top of the 2 meter band has channels that are 15 kilohertz apart. So there's no space in between them for anything else. In the bottom of the band, and in some western states and a couple eastern states, the channels are 20 kilohertz apart. And you can squeeze a D-star signal in between. Now, maybe not a DMR or a fusion signal, but a D-star signal, you can squeeze in between those 20 kilohertz channels on the 10 kilohertz step. But you also have to use a little bit of geographic spacing. You got to push it away from the area so there's less of a chance of adjacent channel interference. I told you why digital is wonderful. Why not? Well, there is a learning curve. You know, how hard can it be? There's a learning curve. You can expect to spend some time, not minutes. It's going to be at least hours. It could be a couple of days before you've got your head fully wrapped around whichever digital mode that you've tried to go in, because there's extra stuff to learn about them. So it takes a while to learn that extra stuff. All right, here's something that is just kind of interesting to know, and beyond my technical capacity, so I'm stealing some of this information from John Hayes, K7VU, in a talk that he did at the Tapper Digital Communications Conference, where he said that these modes are 95% the same and 100% incompatible. That is D-Star, Fusion, and DMR. So what we mean by that is you can't talk to a fusion radio from a D-Star radio or a DMR radio. You know, these radios, they can't talk to each other. So here's, you know, a DMR radio, D-Star radio. In their digital modes, they can't talk to each other. Put them on the same frequency, try to talk to each other, nothing will happen. All of these modes operate FM as well. They all operate analog FM. And if I had a fusion radio, a Yaesu radio here, it would operate analog FM as well. And that makes them compatible at the least common denominator of FM. But in their digital modes, nope, can't talk to each other. There are multi-mode repeaters out there that can repeat and network some or all of the modes, but they are one at a time. So you can't go in on DMR and come out on D-Star through that repeater, for example. There are these hotspot things I was talking about that can transcode between modes, so it gives you some limited functionality in compatibility. I'll talk more about that later on. So are these modes proprietary? Well, no, but only ICOM makes D-Star radios for hams. Only Yaesu makes fusion radios for hams. Kenwood used to make a D-Star radio that's been discontinued. Many companies make DMR radios. I don't know, you know, are they really for hams? Because it's, you know, not really a ham radio mode. But people are saying that they are proprietary. Well, they're not. The modes themselves are well documented. Anybody could make a D-Star radio. Like, you know, for example, Kenwood did for a while. Anybody could make a fusion radio. And again, lots of companies make DMR radios. ICOM and Yaesu and Kenwood could make DMR radios. They just choose not to. Here's what is proprietary in them. All of those modes, all of those radios are using some version of the AMBI vocoder. They can do it with a chip that's in there, or they can do it with embedded software. The vocoder is what takes your voice from the microphone and digitizes it and gets it ready to send out as a digital signal on the radio. And that vocoder is proprietary from the company that makes it. But anyone can buy them, anyone can use them, and they're not that expensive, even in lots of one. At least they didn't used to be. When I did that digital voice documentary, I called up the company, and I asked if I could buy one of those just to experiment with for myself, and they said, sure. I said, and what, it's a couple $100? And they said, no, it's I forget exactly, $10, $20. I'm guessing, because I haven't called them up in 15 years, but you can buy one today. If you want to roll your own D-Star, DMR, or Fusion radio, you'll have to get one of those chips, but you can buy one and build your own. So this notion of proprietary still bugs hams, even with just it being just the chip. So that's why there's M17. David Rowe, a ham down in Australia, invented Codec 2 about a decade ago. Codec 2 is entirely open source, and anybody can use it. Anybody can modify it, and it is available. It's being used on HF, and now it's starting to be used on VHF and UHF in this mode called M17. So for M17, it's early days. It's experimental. I am told, well, I guess, you know, with good authority, that you can modify one of these MD380 radios to operate on M17. Some of the multi-mode repeaters will handle the M17. I'm not sure what the status is of networking on M17, but all those things are in the works. So M17 is going to be the open source ham radio version on VHF, UHF. At least it'll be one of them. Will it become commercial? Will it become widely adopted? Will you be able to buy an M17 radio and use it and have it connect to networks and do all kinds of cool stuff? I don't know. Nobody knows, but we will see. I kind of like it if they would. There is no amateur radio that does every mode. There have been a few that have been promised that maybe almost kind of sort of came to market, but then they got abandoned. They never really did. I know of three different attempts to make a multi-mode radio. They all fell short. So you want to operate them all? Put three handy talkies on your belt? Perhaps not. So which one? Which one you want to choose? Okay, hold on. We'll take a look at them all. Maybe that'll help you decide. Maybe it's going to make you run away from this digital voice stuff screaming. It may help you decide which mode to choose. Now, again, I made this program for the Charlotte area. So this is what D-Star looks like as reported and made into a map by a repeater book. And their limit in doing that search is 200 miles. So this is what you see 200 miles out from the center of the Charlotte metropolitan area. And there'll be more repeaters on the fringes of this map, but that goes beyond the 200-mile limit. So this is what D-Star looks like. This is what DMR looks like. Okay, so D-Star, that many repeaters. DMR, quite a few more. So DMR, much more popular. And Fusion looks here like maybe a little less popular. Looks like DMR may have the edge, but still quite a few Fusion repeaters, and both of them compared to D-Star, you know, like not so much. And I'm going to zoom in on the Charlotte area just a little bit yet. Fusion around here, even though it looked like it is in our wide version, wide view of the land, maybe looked like Fusion was not quite so much as DMR. Around here, I don't show what each of those repeaters is, but I will tell you that Fusion has a little bit of an edge. There's a few more Fusion repeaters than anything else. Okay, so for the national audience, since repeater book does not have an all USA map, so I can't show you the what it looks like if we mapped all of the digital repeaters for the whole country. So I'm going to make Illinois be the stand-in for the rest of the country. You know, good Midwestern state, and the fact that I lived there for 30 years or so does not influence my decision whatsoever. So here is D-Star in Illinois, and, you know, a bunch of repeaters up here around Chicago, and then a few more distributed around the state. You would see a bunch more around the St. Louis area, except this map is limited to Illinois, so you're not seeing the D-Star repeaters that are in St. Louis. So there's a few in what the Illinoisans call downstate, but a lot up in Chicago. Yaesu Fusion is seeded around the state quite a bit more. Lots more repeaters on Fusion. There's some good reasons for that. Yaesu makes a Fusion repeater, and they sold it inexpensively. The idea was to replace an aging repeater. You could, you know, buy a Fusion repeater, a new repeater, do analog, and also add that Fusion digital stuff. And the people that didn't have a Yaesu Fusion radio, they could still use the repeater in analog. And so that's why, part of the reason why you see so many more repeaters for Fusion. So again, D-Star and Fusion, more around Chicago, but more seeded all around the state. And we'll check DMR. Fusion's got the edge, but DMR is still ahead of D-Star. So Illinois filling in for the rest of the nationwide audience. Some cities have all three, but there's a bunch of areas that only have one or two of the digital modes. So you want to find out what's available in your area. And in addition, it may come down to what do people you know use? What do your friends use? What does your club have? If you know people, if there's a repeater in your area, those things may sway your decision as to which mode to pick. If it's totally wide open for you, well, then maybe it comes down to understanding a little bit about each mode. So let's take a look at D-Star. D-Star uses a single 6.25 kilohertz wide channel. More important to frequency coordinators, but it's interesting that it's such a narrow mode. Programming a D-Star radio starts with some familiar parameters, frequency and offset. You put in the frequency of the repeater, and you put in the offset. There may be some non-standard offsets, more non-standard offsets on D-Star, especially on 2 meters, because D-Star came into existence at a point where the spectrum was pretty full, especially in the major metropolitan areas. There wasn't really room to put in new repeaters. Well, here comes D-Star with its very narrow bandwidth, and frequency coordinators did some finagling with the band plans and the spectrum to squeeze them in. So sometimes they're in between these 20 kilohertz channels, but sometimes they take advantage of other spots in the spectrum that might not allow them to use the standard 600 kilohertz offset on 2 meters. So you may find some non-standard offsets. And the slide that I've got here are the extra stuff that you put into a D-Star radio as you're programming it. So you got frequency, you got offset. You're not going to put in a CTCSS or PL tone. It doesn't use that. D-Star does have its own version of a tone. I'm not even going to talk about it because it's not used very much, but as you get into D-Star, you'll understand what it's got. But there are these four fields, these four things that exist inside the radio as you program the radio. They are based on call signs, sort of. And I'm going to focus on this one called the UR field. UR came from the word your. And initially, when D-Star came out, it was going to be a totally call sign-based thing for this for somebody you wanted to talk to. So down on the bottom, there's my call, M-Y, my call, K-4-A-Q, and some room for a four-digit or four-character addition to that. If you've got a name that fits in four characters, you can put in your name. The R1 and R2 are the repeater you're going to be talking through. You got to get those correct, but a little bit more detail. I don't want to try to teach you how to do D-Star from or any of these modes from A to Z. There are classes, there are D-Star classes that literally last all day to learn all the details of this. This is just an overview. But this UR field, that's the important one because that's the one that controls the D-Star repeaters. So as you, the user, are going to control a D-Star repeater, you're going to be putting things in that UR field. And one of the things that you're going to be putting in there is going to be something that takes you to something called reflectors on a network. And I said that D-Star was, and all of these modes are network-centric. They thrive on networks. Well, this is the D-Star network. It's a collection of what in D-Star are called reflectors. And all a reflector is just a software program running in a data center someplace. So repeaters and these hotspots I haven't really talked about yet connect to reflectors. The data bandwidth of D-Star is not great, but when you add dozens of repeaters maybe together and dozens more hotspots, then you're talking about some bandwidth, a couple of megabytes width. So the reflectors need to be located where they've got plenty of data. And hams work in data centers, and they manage to finagle getting these reflectors in data centers. This chart over on the right that's a little bit too small to see very well, that is some of the reflectors. There's a total of 91 reflectors right now worldwide. And there's some organization to them. they are, you know, they're just not all just random reflectors that you connect repeaters to. They are organized sometimes by region. And if you can squint hard at this chart, you'll see that a lot of these are organized by different regions of the country. Sometimes they're organized by interest groups. So they would be nationwide or worldwide, but according to a specific interest. There's only a few D-star reflectors that are organized that way. And then finally, they tend to be organized by language, because if you're going to operate on a reflector, if you're going to monitor a reflector for a period of time, you probably want the communications going through that reflector to be in a language that you understand. And I've isolated some, again, for the Charlotte market. And another advantage of the networks is they bring traffic to quiet repeaters. One of the big complaints about repeaters, analog or digital these days, is that nobody's using them. There's no activity. They're kind of quiet. So you can bring traffic to a quiet repeater if you want it. There are few D-star repeaters that have enough local traffic to keep them busy. Again, it's a niche mode. So even if you're in a big city, a Chicago, a New York, Los Angeles, here in Charlotte, which is a fairly big city, there's not enough traffic from the local hams on those digital repeaters to keep the repeaters busy, enough to keep them interesting. So you can connect the repeater to a reflector that will bring in traffic from a wider area. And here on this chart, we're talking about reflector 54, and specifically reflector 54C, which ties traffic from the Carolinas around. It's a, you know, it's a Carolina-centric, although we got a bunch of guys in Ohio that use it as well. Some of the reflectors are very busy. Most of them are not, but some of the reflectors are busy. They're concentrations of activity specifically designed to be nationwide or worldwide. So reflector 1C is a worldwide reflector, English-based. So you get hams from all over. 30C is another busy one. And a few others tend to get busy with their regional traffic. Even 54C for all the Carolinas, it doesn't stay busy. And I'm listing here for the Charlotte area guys that here in the Charlotte area, the repeaters up on Crowder's Mountain over in Wingate and Albemarle, they stay full-time in 54C. A few other repeaters around the state and a lot of folks running hotspots will leave them sitting on the Carolina reflector 54C. The traffic is still kind of sporadic on those. And this is what it looks like putting stuff into that that UR field, the YOR field. It tells repeaters what to do. It can tell a repeater, connect to a reflector, disconnect from the reflector. And this is you, the user, driving the repeater. You can echo back your signal. So you can say, testing 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. How well are you hearing my signal? Let go, and the repeater goes back. Testing 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. How well are you hearing my signal? It doesn't make you sound snide, though. I'm making you sound snide. And you can interrogate the repeater to see, are you connected to something? It's a handy thing to know. If the repeater that you're going to use is connected to a reflector, if you want to go do something with it, it's been quiet for a while. You want to do something with it, but you want to know, is it already connected to something? So you can find that out. And this is what it looks like programming an ICOM 5100. This is a screenshot off of my 5100. When I'm telling my mobile radio to tell the repeater to connect to reflector 54C. These are the digits that I'm putting in very specifically. I'm telling it to put in REF054CL. And the REF054C is reflector 54C. And the letter L tells it to make the link. So I put that in my radio, key up the radio, just kerchunk for a second, and the repeater makes that connection. There's also something in D-Star radios called DR mode. You program all of your parameters, the ones I've talked about so far, you can program them into your radio and associate them with a memory channel. And in older radios, that's all you had, the memory channels. For each instruction, you'd have a separate memory channel. So you want to connect to a repeater on one reflector, that's a memory channel. A different reflector, that's another memory channel. Instructions to echo or interrogate a repeater, two more memory channels. in newer ICOM radios, they've got something called DR mode. And they store, literally store a database of all the D-Star and FM repeaters for a region of the country. They don't store them for the entire country, but it's a big region, like all the Northeast, all the Southeast, all the Midwest. And they use the radio's GPS to display a list of nearby repeaters. And it can be nearby digital repeaters, it could be nearby analog repeaters, or it could be both. And once you pull that up, you can look through that list and pick a repeater to communicate with. I'm not going to go into any more detail with it. I just wanted you to know that that exists. Here's the current D-Star radios from ICOM and a list of the discontinued radios. Again, it's been around for a while. So the ID52 Handy Talkie is going to cost you $650 or so. The ID5100 mobile radio is the bargain of the bunch of any of the radios, well, excluding DMR. $450, I've seen them as low as $400 on sale now and then. The radio's been around for about 7 years. It was first introduced about 7 years ago, which is getting kind of old and kind of waiting for a new model. And I think that the COVID era kind of slowed ICOM down. Otherwise, they might have introduced the ID5200. We're kind of thinking, you know, maybe a Dayton, the 5200 will be ready. It'll probably have a color screen. This is just a black and white screen, but it is a touch screen. D-Star is also available in some of ICOM's other multi-mode radios. The 705 is their QRP type backpack radio for HF and VHF UHF, but it contains D-Star. The 905 is that gigahertz radio, the one that does VHF UHF, but also 2.5, 5, and 10 gigahertz. The 9700 is a VHF UHF and 1200 radio, and they include D-Star in that. And the 7100 is another all-band HF VHF UHF radio that's sort of their mobile version. And they put D-Star in that. And you can use D-Star on HF. You might want to think hard about using it on HF, and it sort of works okay. If signals are fading and there's a lot of noise in the band, the D-Star doesn't work quite so well. It's really designed to work on the VHF, UHF bands. But people do use it on HF. One of the things you might want to consider is the signal. Well, on VHF, UHF, the signal is considered a very narrow signal, narrower than analog FM. On HF, it is a wide signal. It's still 6.25 kilohertz wide, but a sideband signal is less than 3 kilohertz wide. An AM signal is still only about 6 kilohertz wide. So D-Star becomes the widest phone signal that would be in use on HF, kind of a spectrum hog in that context. So you can find some places on 10 meters. Maybe if a band like 15 meters is not very busy, you can find some spots where you're not going to be causing anybody else some heartburn because the band is so busy. But you might want to think twice about using it on 20 meters or 40 meters or 75 meters. For the Charlotte folks, there's D-Star repeaters on Crowder's Mountain, on Spencer Mountain, on the Hood Road Tower that's east of downtown Charlotte, in Wingate, which is a suburb southeast of Charlotte, Albemarle, which is kind of a suburb, kind of a rural nearby town, and over on Kings Mountain on the west side of town, near Shelby. So that's just for the Charlotte guys. That's where you'll find D-Star repeaters, which basically is to say there's lots of D-Star repeater capability around the Charlotte metro area. And to recap D-Star, you use it like an ordinary FM repeater or for simplex. You push to talk and let go to listen. Repeaters can be linked to reflectors, which links them to other repeaters and hotspots and stuff. And you can control what the repeater does by putting your commands into the UR field of your radio. And that's all I'm going to say about D-Star. I may have said too much. ASU System Fusion. 12.5 kilohertz wide channel, which is important more to frequency coordinators. I don't think you want to stick one of those in between 20 kilohertz channels because it may be still a little bit too wide. You're going to find more of these repeaters on UHF than on VHF, where there's room in between the existing UHF channels. The System Fusion radios also do APRS, the analog version of APRS, in some of their radios. Yes, APRS is a digital mode. It's packet. And I'm calling it analog because it to make that packet, you're using two analog audio tones being transmitted on an FM radio. So it's a bit of a hybrid. So programming a fusion radio begins with those same familiar parameters. Program the frequency of the repeater and the offset, and it may be non-standard. Maybe we've squeezed in some, using some non-standard frequencies on 2 meters. And then, oh yeah, I think I told you I don't have a fusion radio. So I can't really talk about that in any depth because I haven't had a chance to play with it. I did write the QST article back in 2014 or so about the first fusion radios, the mobile and handhelds. I did the QST review, and I had the ARL's fusion radios to play with for a while, but the network wasn't up. So I got a taste of it, but I couldn't really learn the serious programming for doing fusion. And it was a long time ago, and I don't have the radio. So I can, however, watch a video, and I did watch a video of a guy programming it. I didn't really follow it very well. I didn't spend a lot of time with it. I saw this guy in this video. He pushed a button there that's underneath his thumb there on the left-hand side of the radio, and the radio magically connected to what Fusion calls a room. ICOM calls them reflectors. When we get to DMR, they're going to call them talk groups. But Yaesu calls them rooms on Fusion, and he connected to the CQ Victoria room. So I know he did that. I don't know much else about what he did. So what is fusion? What's the concept of fusion? It's a little bit of integration between digital voice and analog FM modes. Again, I mentioned that Yaesu put out this bunch of repeaters that they sold fairly cheap to put an analog repeater into areas where someone didn't have a repeater or needed to upgrade an old fallen apart repeater that they built back in the 80s. And so they got this nice new repeater that worked on FM, but it also brought the possibility of working on fusion. So the way they set up the repeaters is they can mix and match. They can be all analog. Yaesu's not going to tell you that you have to use the repeater in digital. They're kind of hoping you will, and they provide this function where it can go analog in or digital in, but then analog out. So it can be all digital, it can be all analog, but it can be analog or digital on the input, but all analog on the output. And I think that's fusion. Best I can tell, that's the fusion part of fusion. So we're talking on the repeater, you're an analog guy, and I've got a Yaesu radio that does fusion, and maybe I'm telling you about the fusion part, and maybe you're noticing that I don't have any mobile flutter. I don't have any noise on my signal, even when I'm pretty weak and out there on the fringe. Since they're listening to the repeater in analog, they will get whatever analog noise there is as they receive the signal, but no analog noise from my end of things. And so we're going to try to drag these analog guys along until they finally buy a fusion radio, and then maybe at some point we turn the repeater into all digital, and analog guys can still use it. It'll still work analog to analog. The digital guys, when they use it, it'll switch to fusion digital, and they'll get the benefits of digital both in and out, and then it's no longer analog or digital in and all analog out. But you turn it to that mode after a while, after you've given the analog guys a good taste of what this is all about. Here's the fusion radios that are out there on the market right now. The FTM500, they're kind of expecting it to go on the market at any moment. Don't know if they're going to wait all the way until Dayton 2023. They might do it before that. The FTM400, as I'm recording this on March 13th, 2023, is discontinued, but it's still available. Suddenly, a lot of dealers had them that were saying that they were out of stock. Not too long ago, you know, maybe somebody opened a crate and said, oh, look, got a bunch of FTM400s we didn't know about. They've also got cheaper, less function radios going down in $100 increments or so. The FTM300 and the FTM200, they're both still out there. The FTM100 has been discontinued. A bunch of their handy talkies were discontinued, but they still got two handy talkies. The prices aren't too bad on these, especially that FT70 It's a one band at a time, but it does fusion. And at $175, it's the cheapest of the D-Star or Fusion radios. It's not the cheapest of digital, because that honor goes to the DMR folks. We'll see in a minute. But it's the cheapest way to get into Fusion, and cheaper than anything available for D-Star. Around the Charlotte area, a bunch of Fusion repeaters. You can pause this slide if you want, if you're here in Charlotte, and see where the Fusion repeaters are near you. And to recap, once again, you use it like an ordinary FM repeater or simplex. You push to talk, let go to listen. Repeaters can be connected to rooms, which links them to other repeaters, and maybe other stuff, because I don't know what the depth of Fusion is. I know that Yaesu has stuffed other things into Fusion, but I don't know what they are. But they had the opportunity to look around at the D-Star market anyway and to say, we can do different. We can do better. We can add some more things into the mix. So you control the repeaters with what they do with stuff you put into your radio, but I'm a little fuzzy on that because I don't have one. DMR. Okay, here we go. Complexity begins here. Okay, Yaesu Fusion and ICOM's D-Star are designed for amateur radio. They are ham radio, pure ham radios. They do things the way ham radios, you would expect a ham radio to operate. They add their modes and all the unique and somewhat complex stuff that goes into those modes, but they are ham radios. And if you're operating them on FM, they're just like everything else you used for FM, doing all the things you expect. DMR is a commercial system that has been awkwardly adapted to amateur radio. DMR exists at all because it's a cheaper alternative to P25 for businesses in low-budget public safety. P25, APCO 25, is the digital mode that's been around for a long time, 35 years or so, was designed for public safety. And the radios are expensive. Motorola radios are particularly expensive, you know, $5,000 to $8,000 for a handy-talky, something hams would never consider. DMR was designed to be a cheaper alternative. Now, the commercial DMR radios going into commercial service is still fairly expensive. They can go into the thousands of dollars. But there's lots of stuff that is available cheaper that has, again, fallen out of the commercial market. Some of the commercial stuff is not horribly expensive that a ham might not consider it. But stuff is being made, especially in China, for the ham market, but still being made in the manner of the commercial radios. Okay, so why do we want to do DMR? That mountain thing, you know, because it exists, because we can. And if something is possible, some hams are going to do it. But also, well, DMR works really well, RF-wise. Some folks think it works better than D-Star and Fusion. Maybe. Probably not, but some people think it does. Or they just want something different. D-Star's been around for a long time, and some hams didn't like some of the things about D-Star. And then this DMR thing came, developed in Europe, and they said, that's a digital mode that works differently and maybe a little bit better than D-Star, and so let's try that. So they brought it into ham radio, they put up repeaters, they got networking together, and it really took off. And why did it really take off? Because of this radio, this one radio, the TYT MD380, which long about 2015 was selling for about $100. And at that point, Fusion was just getting started. It was expensive. D-Star was expensive. Even, you know, my pride and joy D-Star radio here at the time, the ICOM 92AD, I think this radio cost me about $650 at the time. It's pretty expensive. So this DMR radio, this TYT DMR radio at $100 was my first DMR radio. And as I was getting my feet wet in the DMR networking and talking to other hams, my guesstimate is that 3 out of 4 hams that I talked to on DMR were also using the MD380. I met a few hams that had Motorola radios. You know, we bowed at them, genuflected a little bit. Connect Systems was also putting out some DMR radios, handy talkies, and mobile radios. But this MD380 at $100, that was the radio. About DMR, 12.5 kilohertz wide channels, but in that 12.5 kilohertz, there's two distinct voice channels. I'll explain that a little bit more in a moment. Programming begins with your familiar parameters, ones we've talked about for everything, frequency and offset. Again, maybe some non-standard offsets, although for the DMR radios, I'm not seeing them so much. And then we add, oh my God, we add a lot. Add a lot of stuff that is totally unfamiliar. We add talk groups. Talk groups are similar to reflectors in rooms, but they have some interesting different qualities. I'll explain in a little bit too much depth in a minute. We add color codes. Color codes are similar in function to CTCSS. I'll explain, I got a slide for them in a minute too. We add time slots because of the two voice channel things. I'll explain that. We'll add zones similar to banks. I'll explain that. And we add scan lists. I'll explain that. So much to explain on DMR. And again, without making this an all-day long DMR seminar, this is going to be a bit truncated. Let's tackle the two voice channel thing in one RF signal. How do they do that? Well, it's called time division multiple access, or TDMA. Each channel has two time slots. The time slots are 35 milliseconds long, so pretty fast. 30 milliseconds of that, I'm going to say that's as data. Now, the data includes your voice. Most of that data is going to be your voice, but some of it is some other stuff, including forward error correction. Then there's a 5-millisecond guard band time, and I'm going to demonstrate what that sounds like on an FM receiver here. So bring me back. Here is an FM receiver. This is a Yaesu THF6. This is just plain old open squelch. So that's what open squelch sounds like, and D-star. So not too different. The D-star doesn't sound all that different than the open squelch. If you're, once you get to understand it, you'll understand the difference. This is that DMR signal with the 35 millisecond transmit receive switching going on. You can hear the fast transient switching. Okay, can you hear that fast switching going on back and forth? And by the way, if you tune in a repeater on DMR, you won't hear it do the switching because the repeater is sending out information on both of the 35 millisecond time slots. So it's just going to be that continuous hash sounding more like the D-star signal. So your voice gets digitized by the ambi vocoder. It digitizes 70 milliseconds worth of your voice, and then it squeezes it down into the 30 millisecond burst, and then it's expanded back into your receiver. And on the receiver side, it's seamless. You don't hear that switching between the 30 milliseconds. And so that's why the time slot becomes one of the parameters you program into the radio. It's got to know, do you want to talk to the repeater on time slot one or time slot two? So we talked about talk groups. Well, I mentioned the term talk groups a moment ago. Talk groups are like reflectors and rooms. They are divisions of network activity, but they're a little different because they are a feature of commercial trunked radio systems. It would take me a long time to totally explain a trunked radio system. So I'm not going to do that, but I'll say that what talk groups are the various subdivisions where ham radio operators hang out. They can be set up the same way that the D-Star reflectors and the Yaesu rooms are set up by regions, interest groups, and languages. Over among the commercial people, a talk group was for different agencies or different departments within an agency. So you got a police department, and they may have a couple of, four or five different precincts. and they are using a trunk repeater system, so they're sharing a few RF transmitters, and the way they create virtual channels on their trunk repeater system, the virtual channels are talk groups. And so the dispatch channel, the dispatch virtual channel for the north side of the city precinct is their talk group. And then the west side of the city has got a precinct and another talk group. And the officers driving around in the north side precinct don't want to hear the west side, the south side, and the east side precincts. So they don't hear those other talk groups. Their radios remain silent. That's the way the DMR system is designed. And so the talk groups in ham radio DMR systems can't hear the talk groups they're not programmed for. That's kind of awkward. That doesn't sound very ham radio to me. So the newer radios have a workaround. They've got something called digital monitor or promiscuous mode. Ooh, promiscuous mode. So this is what two different radios look like. It's the same function, just different words. And even though some radios will just call it digital monitor, the hams have latched onto that term promiscuous mode. They like saying that. So you're going to hear them refer to that for everything. You turn on promiscuous mode, and now you can hear everything that's coming out of the repeater. With the older radios, you're only going to hear what's going on the time slot that you're tuned to. With the newer ones, my Anytone handy talkie, that's what you see on the top, that its digital monitor is capable of telling the radio to listen on both time slots, basically play me anything. So that's nice. That allows me to monitor what's going on, but there's still a problem. I can't just talk back. I've got to get that talk group programmed into my radio more than just monitoring it so that I can talk back through my repeater and have my signal go to the correct talk group. It's a little bit complex, kind of maybe a hard concept to understand, but it is an example of how we are just kind of force-fitting awkwardly DMR into ham radio. DMR networks, there are lots and lots of DMR networks, and each network has dozens or hundreds or maybe thousands of talk groups, or they may have just a few. I am not an expert on all of the DMR networks, not by far. I asked Google to give me a comprehensive list of the DMR networks that exist out there, and it choked. It couldn't do it. Maybe I should have asked ChatGPT if it could figure it out. Best I could tell, there was no up-to-date list. I'm familiar with basically three, and these are the ones that are in use locally. There is a network called PRN. It's a regional network. It's just in the Carolinas. I'm going to detail that a little bit for the Carolina guys. But, and you nationwide guys, you might recognize that there's some networks that are regional in your area that may be similar to PRN or maybe not. There's Brandmeister and there's TGIF, and I'll talk about each one of those in a moment. And a little side note there, repeaters aren't your only path to DMR, to the networks. The hotspots also get you into the networks, some of the networks, so stay tuned. So a little bit of PRN. Five of the area repeaters around the Charlotte area are on the PRN network. It is a regional network. There's 54 repeaters around North South Carolina and a little bit of Virginia. By my count, there's 54. There might be a few more. PRN has limited themselves to be pretty much just its own closed network. So limited number of talk groups. They got the main PRN network on time slot 2. There's a local channel on time slot 1. So every repeater lets you talk locally without going out to the network by just switching to time slot 1. And then they've got two chat channels. They become basically on-demand chat channels. So you're talking over on the main PRN network to somebody on the other side of the state. And you realize you're going to go on for a while, and you don't want to tie up the main PRN thing. So you say, let's go to chat 1 or chat 2. So you switch your radio to where you've got chat 1 or chat 2 programmed in. It switches you to time slot 1, and you key up, and it makes your repeater connect to a talk group that is on chat 1 on time slot 1. And the guy you're talking to does the same thing on his local repeater. And now you got a point-to-point connection through the network with just those two repeaters connected. Although I will admit that if I'm hearing two guys in different areas, I'm listening to them on the main PRN network, and they say, let's go over to chat one or chat two. I'll take my local repeater and bop it over to chat one or chat two just to listen to those guys for a while, assuming nobody's already using time slot one on my local repeater. And things are quiet enough generally that works. The PRN network does not allow hotspot connections. It doesn't allow any outside network. You can't get into it from Brandmeister or TGIF or whatever your other DMR network might be. You can't get into PRN using those. It's a little closed world, and it's not very busy. Information for the Carolinas-centric guys. PRN does some MCOM connection stuff. The South Carolina repeaters on PRN are mostly part of something called the SC Hearts network. And in North Carolina, on the western part of the state, they've created a network for the western branch areas of emergency management through ARES. And so they've got their own little network going that connects 17 of the western area PRN DMR repeaters together on a special network. So I won't go into detail on that. You can look at the slide for those of you in the Carolinas and learn a bit more about how that works. Brandmeister is the 800-pound gorilla of DMR networks. And around the Charlotte area, there's only two repeaters that connect to Brandmeister. PRN has been around for a while, longer than Brandmeister, and has kind of gotten most of the repeater activity in the Carolinas area. So only a few repeaters have opted to go Brandmeister, and usually if there's already a PRN repeater in their area. So that's the case around here. So there's a group in the county west of Charlotte, and their big wide coverage DMR repeater is on Brandmeister. Brandmeister's got, according to their website, 5,600 affiliated repeaters, 1,640 different talk groups and counting. Most of those talk groups carry low to no traffic. They're local, regional, or by interest groups. Every state automatically gets a talk group. Every call area, so like the fourth call area's got one, the first call area's got one. Lots of various groups have them. Some of them use them, some of them don't. It's fairly easy to create a Brandmeister talk group. If you've got a group that wants to have your own talk group, you can do that. There are a few high traffic, busy all day type talk groups. One of them is called 3100. 3100 is also bridged to other DMR networks. There's a talk group called 91, which is Worldwide English, a talk group called 93 for North America. Those tend to have traffic off and on pretty much all day. So if you've got a repeater in your town that's pretty quiet and you want to have some activity, you can put one of those networks on there. And again, you got that DMR advantage of two time slots. So one of your time slots can be busy with traffic all day long. It may not be local traffic, but it still is interesting to listen to, and you can get back in and talk or use that talk group, take your share of time on that talk group and still have local activity or connect to other talk groups on the other time slot. So big advantage, like double the capability by doing DMR. Part of the reason why DMR is so popular. I also mentioned that on Brandmeister, there are 19 talk groups, 310 through 319, that are called TAC channels. And the idea of them is that if you've been having a conversation on one of the busier talk groups, maybe you're on 91, Worldwide English, and you realize the guy you're talking to, you want to talk to him for a while. You want to have a 30-minute conversation with somebody. You've discovered you got something in common. The idea is you move to one of these TAC channels and have your extended conversation. And now you and the guys who were in my forum in Charlotte yesterday and I are the only people in the world who know this. Oh, it's documented, kind of buried deep in the documentation for Brandmeister someplace, but I never hear anybody talk about that. I never hear anybody on any of the busy talk groups say, let's move on over to a TAC channel. I don't know why. They don't understand that, but they don't. Here's something cool about Brandmeister. You can go to their website. This is what they call the hose line. It will show you all the talk groups. and the screen you're seeing right now is just a limited selection of them. And the ones that have a red line around them are the ones that are currently actively somebody's talking on. The other ones on this screen are talk groups that somebody has talked on within the past minute or so and are likely to get busy again. And you can tap on those and listen, actually monitor the traffic through your computer. So it's a cool thing that is called the hose line. So drop over on Brandmeister and check that out. The other network that I know a little bit about is called TGIF. Thank God it's Friday. There's a repeater just down the road from us that's connected to TGIF in Shelby, North Carolina. Their website doesn't say very much about it. It's a multi-mode repeater. It also supports D-Star, so I don't know if they actually sit on a TGIF talk group very much. Maybe you can just dial one up over there. I can get on TGIF with my hotspot. I've done that a little bit. My understanding from hearing people talk is that some folks just got kind of unhappy with Brandmeister, and they created TGIF. So, you know, maybe that's really what happened. It's not an official statement, but I've heard people saying the operation is very similar to Brandmeister. They've got a bunch of talk groups, you know, 1,300 of them, quite a few. And if you're on a repeater or a hotspot, you drive that repeater or hotspot to the talk group of your choice. And so now you can choose Brandmeister or TGIF, or again, dozens of other networks out there that I don't know very much about. Programming a DMR radio, this is something that people will tear their hair out a little bit. Without a computer, if you want to program a DMR radio and you don't want to do it through a computer, well, on older radios, and even some of the current radios, you just plumb can't. They're designed or modeled after commercial radios. They give you limited front panel or keyboard programming. You can put in a few limited parameters, but not very much. There are some newer radios, like the Anytones that I've got, where you can program everything in from the keyboard, but it's tedious. It's too many parameters to program if you're going to program a lot of repeaters. You want to learn how, for a field emergency, but mainly for programming your radio, you want to do it on a computer. And so some DMR speak here, the CPS, or the customer programming software, or the factory programming software, is free from most manufacturers. So if you buy a radio, you can probably get some free software to program it. RT Systems makes programmers for some DMR radios. I think they're just kind of getting their feet wet in DMR radios. And then there's something called a code plug. I'll explain that. Well, code plug is a programming file. ICOM doesn't call programming a D-Star radio a code plug, but on DMR, we do. But it's exactly the same thing. Color code. It is a number, not a color. It is from 1 to 15. They are embedded in the data stream along with everything else. It works like tone or CTCSS or PL. The receiver or repeater ignores signals that have a different color code. One of the things you learn about the repeater you're programming into the radio is which of the color codes you're using. And it can keep users and repeaters out of each other's hair. If there's two repeaters that sort of overlap coverage areas, so I'm talking through my local repeater. There's one 80 miles away, but during a band opening, you know, I could get into it. I'm using talk groups that repeater knows about, but I got a different color code. So it may hear my signal, but it's going to ignore my signal. Same as using subaudible tone. This is a complex thing in DMR. It's the user ID and contact list. On D-Star and Fusion, you actually embed your call sign in the radios. You program your call sign into the radios. It gets embedded into the data stream. It actually becomes your legal ID. You don't have to ever speak your ID on D-Star and Fusion because legally you're identified. Everyone does. Everyone still says their call signs, but technically you don't have to. DMR is a commercial system. It doesn't do call signs. But there is something in the radio that is unique to each radio. There's a number. You can put the number in that is going to be unique to each radio. You put the number in, the radio ID number, and it doesn't come with a radio. You stick it in there yourself. You get it from a website called radioid.net. It's free. My DMR user ID is 318-1190, and you know, I got it from radioid.net. But there's more to it, and there's this database thing of all the repeater IDs, or no, all the DMR IDs that have been distributed to hams worldwide since the beginning of ham radio and DMR. 234,690 of them as of March 6th when I made up this slide. That's how many IDs are out there. RadioID.net picks up more than just your call sign. They can get your name, your city, and that information they put into a database, and it can show up on the screen of the guy receiving your signal. And you can see two examples of it on two different radios. See, you know, K4AAQ, Fort Mill, South Carolina, name is Gary, in the United States. So the database lets your radio associate all that information. But where does the radio get the database file? Well, you have to put it there, and you have to update it every now and then. Again, the database sits on radioid.net. You can get it from there. Your CPS, your programming software, can help you do that. RT Systems taps into that database directly. Just push some buttons, and it takes all the database and puts it into your radio. If you've got some of the other radios, you might have to do a little bit more work. But the database sits in your radio. All the radio ever hears from the network is the number that someone programmed in from their radio that they got from radioid.net. And then your radio makes the connection and displays all that stuff on the screen. Well, that's very cool. But there's a problem. The commercial DMR system never anticipated hundreds of thousands of users. So early on, the radios were designed to hold maybe 1,000 or so of these IDs or contacts. Well, as of March 2023, the radio ID database was almost 235,000 entries, and it's growing every day. So, what if you got one of those radios that only does 1,000, or maybe as people were making radios that they were intending to sell into the ham market, they said, okay, well, let's go to 100,000. How could we possibly use that up? Well, we did. We blew past 100,000 a long time ago. So if you've got one of those radios that won't hold everything, you may have to do some truncating of your list. The newest radios coming onto the market, my Anytone, Handy Talkie, and Mobile hold 500,000 contacts. All right, we aren't even halfway there. Will we ever get there? I mean, worldwide, there's a few million hams. Are a few million hams all going to get on DMR? Well, maybe. Zones, something else that is not completely unique to DMR radios, but kind of. All DMR radios, at least all the ones on the market so far, use a zone system for channel management. Zones are like memory banks. A lot of ICOM radios have memory banks. Some Yaesu memories have memory banks. Kenwoods don't. It's too bad. I like memory banks. Memory banks let you gather some of the memory channels that you've got into radio, put them into a bank, and then you can tell the radio, pretend that the only frequencies, the only memories in this radio are the ones in this bank. And it may be 5, maybe 50. ICOM's limited to 100. If I've got my radio programmed with, you know, hundreds and hundreds of repeaters, but not all of them are in the area I'm in now, I've got a memory bank that has the Charlotte area repeaters. I got a separate memory bank because I travel up to Raleigh a lot. A separate memory bank for that trip. It's got the stuff that's along the way and the stuff that's up in Raleigh. I go to the Wilmington area fairly often, so I have a memory bank for the Wilmington repeaters. Lots of reasons for creating memory banks. Well, DMR radios require you to do that. They all have zones. They use them for memories. But they do have memory channels. As you program your frequencies into your radio, they're going into memory channels, pretty much like ham radios. But at least with my Anytone radios and my TYT radios, I can't access those directly. I can't just dial up whatever I've got in memory. I can only access them those through zones. So each channel goes into one or more zones. You'll have to get used to the idea of zones. And I will see on the Facebook groups where people are asking questions about getting on to DMR, they'll say, I program my DMR radio on it, but none of the channels show up. And someone will say, dude, you got to put them into a zone. You create your own plan for zones. It could be geographic. It could be put the DMR repeaters in. And all these radios do analog as well. So you know, analog on one zone, DMR on another, but you can mix and match the analogs if you want. If you've got an event or a specific activity, you can make a zone for that. Scan lists, a little bit weird to even have to mention this, because all our radios do scanning, all your old analog radios do scanning, but how do they decide what they're going to scan? The ICOM radios can scan a memory bank, or they can scan everything that's in memory, all of them all at once. DMR radios, at least the ones I've encountered so far, can't do that. You can't scan a zone. You can't scan all your memories. You have to create something called a scan list. And as you're building a scan list, you can pick from all of the memories in the radio and put them into the scan list, although the scan lists I've got in radio so far tend to be pretty limited to like 50 entries, and then you're done. And that's not enough, but that's what you get. And then the weird thing is that the scan lists get associated with a channel. You program a channel together. You put in the frequency, you put in the offset, you put in the time slot, you put in the color code, you put in the talk group, and then you put in the scan list that you want the radio to start scanning when you're sitting on that channel and you push the scan button. So that's a little weird, but that's the way they work. I wish my DMR radios would let me scan a whole zone, but they don't. I wish they could let me put more than 50 channels into a scan list, because then I could make a scan list that is basically the equivalent of a zone, but they don't. So be aware that these things called scan lists exist. So let's put it together for DMR radios. Much easier to program if you use a computer. You're going to program frequency, offset, talk group, color code, time slot, scan list. Gets a little confusing, but that's DMR. The radios, it's hard to get a handle on all the DMR radios on the market. That's why you're not seeing a picture of all the radios. They're all made in China. Many are rebranded clones of other radios. It's the same way that the Chinese manufacturers are doing it for FM radios. Now, I've seen a few that have been around for a while, names that you see consistently, and then some come and go. So these are the ones that I've seen around for a while. TYT makes HTs and a mobile, and they still are pretty commercial-oriented. The ones that they make, they're not very, very ham radio-like. Anytone makes an HT and a mobile, and they are more ham radio-like. They are designed for the ham market. The same radios are designed and reprogrammed to behave like a commercial radio, and they're certified for Part 90. They can be used in commercial service. But they can also be programmed specifically to be operated as ham radios. They do work a little differently than an ICOM or a Kenwood radio. They are close to ham radio-like, but not completely 100% ham radio-like. But the thing to watch out with any tone radios is that they've only got a few basic models. And the current two basic models are the 878 handheld and the 578 mobile. But they have updates and versions of all of those radios, you know, the Mark IIs and Mark IIIs and pluses and pros. And so it gets confusing with the model name, because you'll start with the 878 handheld and 578 mobile, and then you get a version 2 and a version 3 and a plus and a pro. And the programmings are not particularly compatible among them. So watch out. BTEC, a company that generally makes a sort of rebranded and somewhat customized Bofarm radios, also seem to make a rebranded Anytone, best I can tell from looking at it. Alenco, which is a Japanese brand, sells a DMR radio, but it also appears to be a somewhat repackaged Anytone radio. And I can't tell if they have really changed much in terms of the programming or firmware. Maybe they did, maybe they didn't. Radio Oddity, I've never had one of their radios, but they're around a lot. They appear to be a rebranded TYT. Once again, did they change anything in firmware? I can't tell. And I see this name called Redivis, and looking at the pictures of their radios, they don't look like anybody else's. So I can't tell. Are they making their own totally? I don't know. It's a bit of a wild, wild west, but really it's the wild, wild east, because it's China that this stuff is coming from. It can be a little hard to tell. Stick with TYT or Anytone or something that you, where you know somebody that's got something they can show you. Maybe that's the way to do it. Okay, recapping DMR. You use it like ordinary FM or simplex. You push to talk and let go to listen. Repeaters can be connected to talk groups, which links them to other repeaters. You control what the repeater does by selecting a zone and a memory channel that is set for a specific talk group. Push the button on the radio. The repeater responds by going to this talk group. The talk group may already be full-time on a repeater. If it is, then you're ready to go. If the talk group is on demand, then you just key up and the repeater links to that talk group. Now, there's some limits to that. The repeater owners can limit, they limit things by, first of all, what network they're on and what talk groups are available on that repeater. Brandmeister is the most open and wide open. You know, pretty much if you're on a Brandmeister repeater, you can probably get to any available talk group on it. I think TGIF works the same way. And as we have seen, PRN only limits you to what's available on PRN. So I have mentioned these hotspot things quite a bit. Let's detail them some. They are your backdoor to the networks into both all three, D-Star, Fusion, and DMR, and to some extent, P25 and NXDN, maybe M17. With these devices, you can get into some or all of those networks. They come in two flavors. They come in a version that makes your own little low-power mini repeater. It's got a tiny antenna on it, might run about 10 milliwatts, sits on your shelf. You can walk around with your handy-talkie around the house or maybe a couple houses away and talk through talk groups. You can even tell the device what talk group to connect to or disconnect from right from your radio with, again, all of those parameters that you put into the radio. There are several of them available. There are some that are off-the-shelf complete, some that are kits or homebrew. And again, you walk around your house with your HT and talk to them. There's a version that's not really called a hotspot, you know, more just a USB dongle interface. You talk to the network using your PC, using your mic and speaker with your PC. No RF involved at all, just your home internet and this dongle device. I'll show you some pictures in a second. There's several of them available. They're not very mobile. You're going to, you know, plugging them into a PC. So, you know, maybe if you've got a mobile PC, you can plug one in. Technically, they're not a hotspot because that usually refers to the device that is going to be somewhat RF-based. Why would you want to use a hotspot or a USB dongle? There are some good reasons to. You're not going to be tying up a repeater for long-term monitoring or long conversations. So maybe your local repeater is connected to a reflector or a room or a talk group, but you want to listen to a different reflector or room or talk group, and you want to monitor it for a long time. Well, you can't. You can probably change your repeater for a few minutes, but you can't change it for a long time because the owner of the repeater and the other group has said, this is where this repeater is going to sit. So yeah, move it over, have your conversation, but then move it back, or probably it's going to automatically revert back after you stop using whatever you have switched to. So if you want a long conversation or you want to just monitor some talk group that's not available on a local repeater, these devices will let you do it. They'll also let you play a lot more, switch between reflectors or rooms or talk groups at will, you know, a couple of them a minute. Any activity here? Nope. Any activity here? Nope. Any activity here? Oh, yeah. I can listen to these guys for a while. Doing that on a repeater, you could do it on the repeater. You'd probably irritate the other people listening to the repeater. So do it at will on your own local little hotspot. Some hotspots can transcode, so you can connect to any network, whether they're using DMR, D-Star, Fusion, whatever. You can do it from your PC. There are some that even do it on RF. So you want to connect to a Fusion room, but you got a D-Star handy talkie. Well, you can go through this hotspot and transcode and make that connection. You can access repeaters, or rather, you can access the networks and the talk groups, etc., where there's no repeater available at all. And there's lots of the country that doesn't have any of these digital repeaters. So if you want to play, you can do it with a hotspot or a dongle. You can set them up, some of them set them up mobile using your phone's internet or a mobile access point. And that gives you continuous coverage when you're on the road. So if you're driving along in and out of coverage of repeaters. You don't have to worry about finding the repeaters and finding the talk groups. You can connect using your hotspot as long as you have cell coverage. So let's look at some of the devices that actually exist out there. These are the actual hotspots. You can see most of them have a little antenna sticking up. In the upper left, the Zoom spot or Zum spot, USB, which is the cheapest one here on the list. It does have an antenna. It's just built in. So it's going to be very limited coverage. The other ones, you can disconnect the little stubby antenna and connect a bigger antenna or even an outside antenna on the roof for coverage up to a quarter, maybe half a mile. Just an example of what's out there. That one in the lower right, the red one, the DV access point, DVAP, I think that's been discontinued. I'm not finding that available anyplace. Sort of the original and D-Star only. Everything else will be multi-mode. That OpenSpot Pro at $350, the most expensive, but also the most plug-and-play off the shelf of all the devices. And here's the dongles that are available, which is actually not very many. And there may be some out there that I'm not familiar with, but this is all I could find, and I did some research. So the DV Mega is the one you can actually buy now, about $110. The Thumb DV, about the same price. I'm seeing it says sold out. I expect it will come back on as soon as they can get the parts to sell some more. And those are the only two that I found. The blue one over on the right, the DV dongle, D-Star only, it is literally the first of these devices to plug into a computer and let you talk into a network. It came out very shortly after D-Star came out. And since it's so limited and D-Star only and was pretty expensive, it's now no longer available. That DV Mega Cast is a really odd duck. It's a box. It looks like a radio. You look on the back and there's no antenna connection. It's a purely IP-based. The idea is you can run this without a computer and talk into any of the networks, transcoding, and get, no RF. It's not going to transcode your handy talkie, but it's going to let you talk to any of the D-Star, DMR, Fusion, maybe the P25, I don't know, NXDN. M17, it's pretty expensive for, $400 for a device that doesn't do any RF, but if you want something sitting on the desk and not have to use something connected through your computer, maybe that's the device for you. So if you are going to use your computer, most of these, well, all of these require, some kind of software for control and setting them up. And this is the most common. This is software that will run on a PC called BlueDV. It's a user interface. It works on the DV Mega and the Thumb DV. The RF ones, some of them may have this kind of interface. Some of them will have a web. You get into them from a web browser, and they'll present like a web page through a browser where you make your control and stuff. But BlueDV is where you do the DV Mega or the Thumb DV. This is where you're using your PC microphone, PC speakers to talk in and receive. No RF involved on your end of things. And it will work on the DV network, on the D-Star network, on the Fusion network, and NXDN. I don't know if they have a version capability of connecting to anything M17 yet or not, or P25. Maybe, but doesn't look like it from what I'm looking at here. I'm part of, and this program was sponsored by the Charlotte Digital Radio Group. It's an informal, non-club group. They sponsor several of the digital repeaters on different modes around town. And if you're ever in the Charlotte area on the third Thursday of the month at 6 p.m., join us at the Park Place Restaurant on Park Road in Charlotte. It's actually in the kind of a nearby suburb called Pineville. And so come join us for dinner. It's a cool little restaurant. Go there a lot. And that will be it for this very special episode of Digital Ham Radio Now, Digital Voice 2023, the VHF UHF edition. Recorded here on March 13th, 2023. Things may change by the time you receive this this show. I'm Gary Pierce, K4AAQ. I'm the king of AM, king of DV anyway, on the Ham Radio Now. So also enjoy you. I also encourage you to enjoy the rest of our shows on the Ham Radio Now, Ham Radio Podcasting Network. We do the video shows on YouTube and on Facebook, and audio on whatever podcast device you use. And when we're done, we say the following words over and out.